Hey guys, welcome back to Clownfish TV. This is Neon. I am here with Geeky Sparkles.
Hello.
And I came across this article this morning. This is Inverse. This is Inverse, which is a very progressive outlet. But it's basically saying that Marvel and Star Wars, Disney Marvel and Star Wars fans are in a cult.
Mm-hmm.
They're in a cult, that there are so many parallels between stan culture and fandom current year. And I think this is so funny because we've been saying this for years.
Yep.
That, you know, look at all the drama around the Star Wars stands and the Raylos attacking YouTubers and all this crap.
And now the Captain Marvel and the Marvel stuff. It's like you are not allowed to not like it.
Yeah, it's a religion. And we're going to talk about that because that actually does dovetail with, you know, the fact that more and more people are calling out Disney as being cult-like and sort of fostering a cult-like audience, and it is religious. And you know, we said before that the worst thing that happened to Star Wars and Marvel, and the reason that you see the people stand for these properties so hard now, is you've got the crazies from the Disney cult bleeding over into the Marvel and Star Wars.
But it,
cults,
yeah, it's just gotten to a place where everything is supposed to be beloved and is the bestest thing ever, and they're going to take things and change it all, and then you're supposed to love it, and if you don't, it's just because you're a heretic and you need to be converted.
Yeah, I mean, how many fake sock puppet stan accounts are there on Twitter dedicated to dunking on anybody who doesn't like a Disney product? I mean, we're talking about one of the most corporate corporations on the planet. I mean, this company, I mean, yeah, it puts on a good face, but the reality is, and we saw it during the pandemic, how they treated their cast members. Disney is a for-profit company. They're just really, really good at giving you the feels, you know, giving you the warm fuzzies and banking on nostalgia. Mm-hmm. But they also bank on people always coming back. It doesn't matter how they're abused or how often they're abused or whatever, you will always come back. And that's why they're like, oh, we can charge whatever the hell we want to mm-hmm. get into the parks. We can kick these people in the
and
face.
They will pay it.
They'll pay it. They'll absolutely pay it. So anyway, we're going to talk about this. It's very interesting to see an outlet like Inverse calling out things that we've been calling out and other YouTubers have been calling out for years.
It's okay now, they say.
It's okay. Well, no, this is what I'm saying. We're seeing a lot of this stuff getting walked back. I mean, just all the way around, it was like, you know, and again, this is my theory of everything, that a lot of these outlets don't actually believe the shit they write. They put it out there because they want you to get angry because it gives them views. So for the longest time, how did they get a lot of clicks on their website? Oh, I'm going to write something about the Phantom Menace and the Last Jedi and the blah, 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 blah.
The search terms.
Yeah, every effing bullet point. And it's not working as well as it used to because people are like, oh, we're on to you. We know what you're doing now. Now they're like, okay, well, we're going to attack the Twitter stans because they'll read our articles. They'll come out in droves and they'll read our articles. Anyway, before we get into it any further, check out Crimson Wren Volume 1 on Indiegogo. We've got 9 days left for the main campaign. We might put it into in-demand for a month or so, get final orders ready. But the book is pretty much done. It has to be lettered and printed, and it's over 130 pages. It's beautiful stuff, beautiful words, which are going to be put into this book. Don't worry, it's not a silent comic. It just needs lettered, and the story is good. The story is very, very good. So let's talk about this. Inverse is fandom a cult? The religious fervor fueling Star Wars, Marvel, and more. In 2015, they talk about sitting outside the movie theater for 5 hours waiting to see a work of art that some have waited decades for. The Force Awakens. Now, to be fair, I did the same thing when The Phantom Menace came out. I literally took off of work to wait in line for 12 hours to get tickets.
I did the same thing, and they did the re-releases for the original trilogy. Yep. I was like one of the only girls in line. My friend and I, who I drug along with me, were like, for the longest time, we were the only girls there because we were the ones crazy enough to sit there. Then later, a bunch of women showed up, but we were the ones that stood in line.
So they're talking about this Levine, again, this professor of religious studies at Lehigh University, which is she's actually been quoted in the Disney fandom too. And we told you before, we said the reason that Marvel and Star Wars have become so freaking toxic over the last couple of years is mm-hmm. you've got the Disney stans the Disney cultists, the Disney apologists bleeding into that fandom.
It's always funny to me. They're yelling about toxicity and they're like, you know, you're not inclusive, you know, everything else. And they keep screaming. And then they insert themselves in there, which is fine, you know, hey, more the merrier, you know. And then it becomes toxic when they come into it and they say, well, it's because they try to push out everybody, they don't, that doesn't align. And they're like, well, it's toxic now. It's like, no, it, yeah, because you're the one gatekeeping it.
Yeah, pretty much. And they talk about that. They talk about, like, you know, doctrinal differences and all this other crap. But they said, sitting outside a movie theater waiting for doors to open on the latest installment of your fictional universe of choice, for example, may be more akin to sitting outside a shrine waiting to pray at the feet of a saint. So they said all fandoms have the potential to become very religious.
Mm-hmm.
They use pop culture to fill the same need that a legitimate religion might in another person's life. You know, the Church of Marvel, what we call religion, is increasingly nebulous. More than a quarter of Americans consider themselves spiritual but not religious. And they said that it is secular. And this is, again, coming from Inverse. They're basically saying that pop culture, secular ideology has become the new religion. And we've said before about a lot of people on Twitter, politics have become the new religion. And you start to get all this stuff intermingled and you basically have this, you know, church-like mentality and the heretics have to be purged.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yes, it is. It's like, if you don't love it, if you don't agree, then you need to be shunned.
Yeah. Disney adults make trips to Disney as a pilgrimage, decorate their homes using the We Do Disney manifesto as a theme, and participate in innumerate rituals. Disney cast members, the firm's name for its employees, are even required to sit through a training class called Disney Traditions. This is true.
Mm-hmm.
You work for Disney, you work in the parks especially, you are indoctrinated. They basically have a Bible school for you to go through a Bible study. Where you learn the company's values and whatever. Then you see them in action during the pandemic and it's like, wait a minute, you lied. Our leaders got to keep all the money.
Now, I want to say though, going to the parks and buying merchandise sometimes or like liking Star Wars movies or Marvel movies and wanting to see when they come out, things like that is not what we're talking about here. We're talking about the people that are so obsessed, so fixated on these, you know, different properties or Disney itself, that to them, you cannot speak ill of it or you are personally offending them in some way. Those are the people, that's what we're talking about.
Wow, this gets crazy, but you know what? I've seen some.
I think they're taking it to a little extreme in this article. They are. I'm not gonna lie. I think they're being a little over the top here.
They are, but I have seen some legitimately crazy behavior. Well, rewriting Ripley was.
Yes. Yeah, they were out there just flat out making shit up.
That was a effing manifesto that they were trying to purge the heretics from their fandom and by trying to. They basically wanted somebody else to get rid of them by trying to tie them to like some far right.
Yeah, they were just flat out making up lies at that point.
Ridiculous. But here, this is again, this is coming from Inverse. They said not all religiosity is benign. Some groups stray toward harmful and isolating practices. I said the most prominent examples of cult-like behavior in fandom can be found in sci-fi, especially in Disney-owned Marvel and Star Wars.
Yeah, make sure they're specifying the Disney-owned.
Disney-owned. At the same time, many real-world cults take direct influence from sci-fi.
That's true.
Heaven's Gate, the cult that took part in mass suicide in 1997, centered its teachings on UFOs and took a lot of inspiration from Star Trek. Before becoming a cult leader, this is true. Uh-huh. L. Ron Hubbard was a prolific science fiction writer. One of his works, Battlefield Earth, was even adapted into a poorly performing movie starring John Travolta. If you're a fan, it's easy to see your fandom community's cult-like behavior if you know where to look. There is an insularity there where the in-group of established fans or followers are given a separate designation from people who casually engage with the given material. Former sci-fi superfan Daniel Hassel tells Inverse he once participated in Marvel, DC, and Star Wars fandoms. You have to prove your credentials in many ways. Make it a lifestyle. They can't allow any criticism of their fandom or faith.
That's just that you can't allow any criticism. And again, Disney owned
for the Star Wars and Marvel, yeah.
For the most part, because it's like these people are just, if you don't like the new movies, it's because you're an istaphobe of some kind. You need to be removed. You need to be discredited. You need to be publicly humiliated and shunned. And it's absolutely stupid. And somehow you're not accepting. I love it. You're not accepting. So that's the people who aren't accepting.
Now, here's where it goes off the rails, and this is where
just now?
Yeah.
I think they're really hamming it up.
This is where I disagree with it, because they are pointing out legitimately, I think, that the Marvel and Star Wars fans are probably the worst right now. I mean, just go to Twitter and you'll see that they're probably
cartoon people are worse too.
But they talk about the cult of canon, basically, that the canon is the holy text and you're not allowed to mess with canon or the religious people come after you. Actually, there are a lot of people cheerleading the old texts being overwritten to appease modern audiences. Yes. And then attacking the people. But again, you could boil this down to like doctrinal differences between mm-hmm. religions. And really, basically, at the end of the day, it's like this fictitious shit means way more to you than it should. Now, where we come into it, we're like, look, at the end of the day, it's all fictitious shit, but a lot of it did mean, you know, a lot to us at some point in time in our lives. But also, I've gotten to a point where I'm willing to walk away from it, but the drama around it and the media supporting the crazies, but they know what they're doing. They know what they're doing. They're like, let's attack, you know, so-and-so because they don't like this or they don't like that or whatever, because the opposite party is going to come into our website and we're going to get lots and lots of clicks, you know?
Oh, you mean the media?
The media, yeah.
Yeah, I'm just sitting here like, I just think it's funny that the people that are complaining about how they, no, we're accepting now are the most unaccepting, toxic people I've ever seen. And then they go on places like Twitter and they're the ones that are spouting off the racial slurs and saying, you know, and shunning people and telling people to kill themselves and all this shit over a show.
They talk about sci-fi as being vulnerable to mob followings, a wealth of content to explore. There are fan theories, fan fiction, fan films. These have their own religious parallel. And the professor from Lehigh University said that the Jewish concept of midrash, meaning textual interpretation of the Torah, is basically the first fan fiction. So again, you have, you know, what's canon, what's decanonized, what's the holy text, you know, what is and what is not canon. And I think really what is and what is not canon at the end of the day is what was the creator's original intent and did you personally enjoy it and did it add to the original story or try to destroy it, you know? So now I'm waiting for them to be like, well, Luke Skywalker had to, you know, just go through some stuff because that's the way the Bible works too. All the heroes of the Bible went through some stuff. And I'm like, yeah.
He did.
He already went through stuff.
I don't know. I honestly, at the end of the day, my takeaway from all this is by them behaving in such a way, by the media perpetuating it, by, you know, companies doubling, tripling down on it, all it's doing is turning away your basic fans, which make up the majority of fans. Most people, you have your extremists who treat it like a religion or a cult on both sides. But the majority of people are just like, I like going and watching the movies. I buy the merch sometimes. I like it. But it's not like, you know, I'm not going to sit here and spend 3 hours, you know, arguing with you over it. And the majority of people are the ones they're turning off.
Yeah, because the normies, at the end of the day, and this has always been the case, you've always had like casual, even when comics sold a hell of a lot more than they sell now. You had your casual fans who would pick up comic books because they were cheap and they were available like 7-Eleven. You know, like, oh, hey, Spider-Man, I'll pick that for my kid or something. And, you know, since you could buy comics everywhere and they were cheap, a lot of people bought them, but they weren't, I don't think a lot of them were comic book super fans. And then you've always had the diehards that have the long boxes full of comics and they know
everything. They read all of them.
They know everything, you know. And they'll tell you they know everything.
And most people fall in the middle where you're just like, you know, You casually like it. You consider yourself a fan, but you're not like so invested in it that it's your life.
I mean, for me, comics, it was, you know, so I loved comics growing up. I also loved tabletop gaming. I also loved video games. I would argue I probably know more about video games than I do about every damn comic book that was out there, but it was all part of the stuff I bought as a kid, you know, comic books, and because that was what was available. You know, played video games, went to the arcade, went to the comic shop, whatever. But, you know, this is really interesting, though, too. They said this is very much like biblical reenactments. Like,
kind of.
It is. They're like people are making a pilgrimage to the theme parks to see biblical reenactments of characters from their holy text so they can be part of the story.
I do think they're being a little bit dramatic.
I mean, this is dramatic, but
they're being a bit overly dramatic here, but yeah.
They said the text is only half of the religious experience. Religions, especially ritual-heavy belief systems, bring people together as a community in terms of behavior. Now, this is going to piss some people off. The MCU understands this fundamental truth better than any other franchise. Because the world of the MCU is so much like ours, it would have to have fans too. Ms. Marvel introduces the concept of AvengerCon, and its protagonist, Kamala Khan, is a fan fiction writing cosplay making fan herself.
And it didn't do well because of it.
It didn't do well. Yeah, well, she wasn't. I mean, that's the thing, is like everybody's like, Ms. Marvel, who?
Well, not just that, but the show itself did not do well. And a lot of it was because people were like, eh, about that. They did. I mean, let's just be honest. It was like, it wasn't very much like an MCU show you're used to. And they're like, basically, it's, and same with She-Hulk. She always kind of was, you know, broke the fourth wall and all that stuff was kind of funny, but they're taking it to extremes and then people are tuning out because they're like, eh.
Wow. At Avengers Campus, Doctor Strange does a show about the mystic arts. Yeah. This is the Professor Levine, Eichler Levine. We know it's an actor in a costume, but all religion is performance. Ritual is kind of performance. That doesn't mean it's fake. It means that it's structured. Also, like mainstream religion, these rituals are deeply steeped in capitalism. For Yi Y, a Star Wars superfan who requested anonymity, I can't imagine why. That's part of the reason people turn to fandoms in the first place. People don't have
See, I was going to mention this earlier. I think they're just trying to fill a void. That's why they get so militant.
Because they, look, I'm not trying to be that guy, and I don't want to bring religious, you know, religion into it and have a discussion about that. But a lot of people that are the most militant defenders of Disney and the MCU and Star Wars are people that probably would describe themselves as atheists, you know, or they're just, you know, religion averse for whatever reason. They feel like outcasts in society for whatever reason, which is why I think this pop culture stuff is
cabal.
pretty much. I think it's very attractive. It's like, oh, it's basically this fills the void. People, look, we're programmed to look for higher meaning. We're programmed to look for structure and meaning in life. And if you don't find it from, you know, religion or within, you know, satisfaction in your life, you're going to turn to other stuff. And that's fine for entertainment, for a distraction, but it's gone beyond that. It's not just about, hey, I want to read a comic book just to, you know, chill out for 20 minutes. It's like, no, I have to live and breathe this. And the people who are dunking on my religion, they need to be smited, because it's so ironic that a lot of these people describe themselves.
They usually fall with Christians suck.
Yeah, they fall with Christians suck. But I'm like, you are literally doing everything that you accuse religious people of doing to you, because they dissed your religion, you know.
And what did you say? It was like militantly atheist. Like militantly, you know, you could be just as religious, you know, about your non-religion.
I would maintain, and I stand by this, I actually believe that atheism is a religion. I believe that any like structured belief system, even if it's a lack of, you know, a belief in a higher power, if it's like structured and you've got, you know, all these kind of things, you've got your organizations.
And if you're out there trying to convert people
and all that, it is a religion. I believe that multi-level marketing can be a religion to people. You see people that are looking for meaning in their lives latch on to things. And Disney's I think it's because it promises magic, you know, promises escapism and magic.
Well, I don't think looking for meaning in your life and assigning it to religion or fandom is necessarily a bad thing.
No, it's not.
If you're gaining something positive from it, I don't think it's a bad thing. Where it becomes a bad thing is when, like we've seen with pop culture in general, is like, you know, if you don't believe it or agree with me, you're a bad person. I'm going to bully you. You are shunned. We're going to kick you out of the fandom and gatekeep you out. Things like that. That's where it goes too far and becomes, you know, a toxic type thing. Then it's not about positivity. It's about, you know, control, and it's about only you and your friends being the type of people that can, and those who agree with you, being allowed to be part of it. So I don't think religion or fandom in general is a bad thing. If it brings positivity to your life and it makes you happy, I think that's completely fine. It's when you start making it toxic or taking it into a negative towards other people that it becomes an issue.
When you threaten to dox or harm people.
People to kill themselves.
Or, you know, try to drive somebody to suicide because they don't like your effing
comic
book.
They didn't do fan art the way that you thought they should or whatever.
Yeah, right. I mean, that's when it's just like, because again, this is like, you didn't draw Jesus right, so you're going to hell. Yeah, people who don't have meaning in life and have left religion as a whole due to capitalism crushing everything. So people need to resort to corporate media. Resort to corporate media to fill their soul.
Disney will be glad to fill your soul as long as you fill their wallet.
Yeah, pretty much. Eichler Levine adds that paying money to get something in return is not unique to fandom. They're talking about tithes and sacrifice and all that. But it is. Then you've got, you know, the big gatherings, the big religious gatherings. You know, hold up your crosses. I mean, your lightsabers. You know, they've got the fan celebrities who aren't directly involved in the franchise, but ends up cultivating a fan base within a fan base of their own. So you've got people that are, yeah, they talk about, TikTokers and YouTubers and, you know, you get down to it though. And they are kind of like, you know, well, some people are just like anti, cause it's like a doctrinal differences or whatever. They said there's nothing wrong. Basically what you said, there's nothing wrong with enjoying things, and engaging with art can be an incredibly moving experience, both personally and communally. However, I think it's unhealthy to ever drive your sense of personality or sense of identity from a given brand or piece of media.
I agree with that too. I mean, in anything. And I also think, you know, it's if you're starting to get so offended that someone doesn't like what you like, the place that you're like doxing them, threatening to kill them.
Like, I want them to die.
Calling them incels or any other name. You try and discredit them over a TV show or a movie or something like that. Then, you know, that's where it becomes really, really bad. And that you're the problem.
Yeah. And it's you know, it's a mess. I mean, at the end of the day, I mean, we talk a lot about the media and we talk a lot about fandom and we talk a lot.
I think it's hard people being vilified wrongly.
That's exactly it.
Under this kind of circumstance.
Weirdly, the people that are the most vilified, if you look at it, a lot of them, I mean, for all this talk of like them being incels and stuff, most of them are married with kids. They have day jobs.
Not filling a void in their life like it's filling the void in the life of a lot of other people.
Right. But then you look at these, you know, some of the other people. Again, this is not a blanket statement, but you look at a lot of the other people. It's like, this is literally all they do. They're like, you know, I'm a professional cosplayer.
I'm on Twitter all damn day.
I'm on Twitter all day because there is a void. And I know in our case, you know, I've looked into some of the people that have taken an unhealthy interest in us. And I can tell you that their own lives are not great. And I'm so sorry for that. But attacking us, or thinking that we are causing your pain when we're just a random, you know, YouTube couple that you can turn off whenever you want to. You don't have to agree with us, whatever. Life goes on for us, you know. But it really becomes very unhealthy. And you see it on Twitter all the time, you know. And I'm at the point where it's like, I don't even want to engage with these people anymore. I'm like, you go be sad someplace else. I am so sorry for you that this is, you know, that Ms. Marvel and Captain Marvel mean more to you than, you know, religion or whatever.
People have stopped talking to family members because they didn't like a certain movie or TV show.
It's so stupid. And politics are the same thing. Politics have become religion.
They are religion, no question.
You know, especially in the last 5 or 6 years, we've seen it, and it's become incredibly divisive, and it's just all a bunch of bullshit, and I don't know, guys. I just think it's funny. I just think it's funny that we're seeing Inverse, of all publications, coming out and saying that Disney, Marvel, and Disney Star Wars fans, you know, have cult-like behavior.
But yeah, it's like, duh.
Duh. Duh. Welcome to the part. I guess they're fandom menace now, right?
I guess. Yeah, clearly. Confirmed.
All right. Are we done?
Yep.
We gonna wrap it up?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Please subscribe for more pop culture news, views, rants, guys. We'll talk later.
Bye.